In this video, we're going to do a severe weather statement to follow up our severe thunderstorm warning from the previous exercise. So the first thing I want you to do is double-click on the cave clock on the bottom of the display, and we're going to change our minutes to 59, so just hold down the spin bar until it gets to 59 and click OK. I'm going to go ahead and toggle off the local warnings because we've got some of the warnings from the local CWA archive, and I just want to keep it simple here. So I want to force this display to update to 2359 by just right-clicking on the small pane over on the side, and then I can right-click on the small pane again, and now my radar data is updated to 2359, and we can have a little bit more context to update our severe weather statement. So the first thing we need to do with WarnGen is select the severe weather statement checkbox. Once we've selected that, then WarnGen disappears for the moment. We can select the warning that we want to update from the follow-up list, but we have to remember our ETN number. Mine was 5010. Yours will be a different number, so you have to remember that in order to select your warning to be able to update it. I have a choice right now to continue or cancel the warning, and I want to continue the warning, so I could select that. The second way that you can access this, if you have the interactive WarnGen is editable, then if you right-click in the location where you had a polygon, it's going to check and it's going to provide that to you in the follow-up list. So I have severe weather statement, continue, my ETN's 5010, I'm good to go. So I could have either just selected it from here, or I could right-click on the location where the polygon was when WarnGen is editable. Next, I want to go to the default settings that I have in here for my warning, and I'm going to change them. I have a spotter report of baseball size hail at 635, so I'm going to change my basis from radar indicated to train spotters reported. Leave the wind threat 60 miles an hour, and then change what had been 2 inches is now going to be baseball size hail. So if I had a 2 inch maximum expected size in my warning, and I expected that to continue, and I hadn't had any reports yet, but I did get in a report of quarter size hail, then I would include the quarter size hail and manually type that in and leave the 2-inch hail selected because it's less than my maximum expected threat. In this instance, the baseball size hail is larger than what we had in our previous warning, so we want that threat tag in the bottom of the warning to say the maximum expected size, which in this case is going to be baseballs. Alright, so I have baseball size hail selected. List of cities is how we had it set before. Calls to action, got the destructive hail there. I don't need my generic threat if I have the destructive hail selected. So after that, I am just about ready to create my text. Only I need to update the motion and the polygon and where the threat area is. So let me step through my loop and see, did I get my motion well done? If so, then I shouldn't have to do anything. Looks like my storm is continuing to move along the same track. I don't need to change my track, but if I did, then I could just use the distance speed tool here to redo my track. Going to change the motion that's in the warning, but I can't have the polygon increase in size. I can only decrease a severe thunderstorm warning with a severe weather statement. So I don't need to modify my track. I just need to adjust this to cover the threat area better. So central high is definitely out of the warning by this time. And let's see if I do something like that, then this looks like a reasonable adjustment to my warning. The main hail threat's kind of right in here. That's moving off to the northeast. You'll notice that all three of these counties are hatched. There's W's in each one of them. So that means all three counties are going to continue. Now if I cut this really close, then I would have this sliver that is unhatched. And so what this is if There's a certain percentage, it's an aerial percentage, that's customized at the local site. You can set how much of an area needs to be covered before it's going to be included in a warning. So we have fallen underneath that area threshold, and so it's going to exclude this county from the warning. It's basically going to cancel this county, and it's going to continue these two counties. Well, right now, I want to keep this area in. So if you ever run into this circumstance where you've got a sliver that you want to keep in, then the only way to get that in is to keep adjusting the area size until it passes that area threshold, and then it gets hatched and put in. So I think there's a hail threat that goes all the way back there. So I'm going to go ahead and include that area in my warning now. If you want, you can tweak it out and then see what happens when the partial cancellation will happen automatically. You'll get one cancellation for Eastern Comanche County and then continuation for these two counties. But I'm going to leave it in and then we'll go from there. Alright, so we have all our stuff selected in here. We have our tracks fine. Our area has been modified some. If we tried to increase this in size, you see that it's not going to hatch anything else, and it will snap it back whenever we create our text. So I'm going to go ahead and hit the Create Text button. After, I need to make sure I have my text workstation up here. You should have yours up, but I've got mine. So let's go ahead and hit Create Text. Going to generate the product. See it snap that back, because again, you can never expand a warning in a follow-up statement. You can only shrink it. So I get my AWIPS header block. Don't change anything. Just click enter. Get my severe weather statement. Locked code in blue. There's my ETN 5010. And I've got Comanche, Stevens, Grady counties in here. So at 6:59 p.m. Central Daylight Time, a severe thunderstorm was located 4 miles west of Marlow, moving northeast at 30. This is where we're going to enter in the time of our spotter report. So this spotter report was at 6:35. So we're going to say at 6:35 p.m. spotters reported baseball size hail 5 miles east-southeast of Lawton. So we are going to include the time of the spotter report here, because we have the radar time here at 6:59. This is when we're updating the position of the storm. It was located 4 miles west of Marlow, moving northeast at 30. At 6:35 p.m., spotters reported baseball-sized hail 5 miles east-southeast of Lawton. We've got baseball size hail, 60 mile per hour wind gusts. In the hazard at the bottom, we have baseball size hail and 60 mile an hour wind, so we don't want to change any of this. Our source is trained weather spotters, just like we had selected. So the whole idea behind a lot of these impact-based warnings, a lot of this text taken care of for you, you're just adding some critical information on the front end, like what's the maximum expected sizes, and then typing in the spotter report information, such as the time in the product. So we just go ahead and click the send button, click go ahead, and go ahead again. Now if I turn back on my polygon displays, I'm going to turn off warn gen. There is my new warning, my follow-up statement right there. So that is the basics of issuing a warning and a follow-up statement. I need to double-click on the D2D clock now, and we're going to go back to 2340 so we can continue on with our other exercises, because this is the only time that we've deviated from 2340 for our exercises here. And now we'll be back to where we were. If we swap panes out, we'll go back to 2337, and you can continue on with the next exercise.